Okay, Peter, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Okay, I think we can already start the webinar. So I think it's
Yeah.
already 12:30. So well, I just want to give a welcome to this webinar. Once again, we thanks for all the attendees. Hopefully you enjoy. And today it's going to be about imbalances in rural primary healthcare. Peter Groenewegen is with us. He is going to be presenting himself shortly here from the NIVEL, from the Netherlands Institute for Health Research. But before going to that, I just want to remind you some very practical things concerning the questions and answer session, because you're going to be able to make some questions to Peter, and that will be in the written form. You had a chat box. Where you can actually write down your questions, and I will be collecting them. So I encourage you to do it along the presentation and not just everything at the end. So if you have any doubts during the presentation, just write down the question in the chat box. And if you really urge to make like I don't know, a statement or some another question to him, just let me know towards in the chat box, so I can give you the right to speak, because otherwise it's going to be a bit messy. But Peter, if you can remind also then about making the questions along the presentation, that will be great.
Yep.
Yeah, it doesn't become very messy. So I just give you the floor, and if you can, Peter, just turn on your camera so people can see who you are, and well,
Is my
start.
camera on or not?
No, it's not. You just
Oh,
have.
okay. Wait a minute. Then I have to first escape from this, go to my camera and see. Okay.
There it
Yeah,
is.
now it's on, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah?
It is. Yeah, we
Okay.
can see you. So I give you the floor so you
I
can.
go back to my presentation. Okay. Okay, then, Diana, thanks for the introduction, and I will start right away. It's about rural primary care. It's a small project that I did together with two of my colleagues, Mark Bosman and Wienke Boerma. Basically, what we did was a quick scoping review during this summer. It was on request of WHO. Our good friend Pavlos Theodorakis is also in the audience, and we had a lot of discussions about this, about the project. It has a focus on the European region, but also used literature from the wider global scene. It covers the period of 2008 to July 2018. I had hoped that it was by now published so that everybody could look at the policy brief and the background report, but it will soon be published. I hope there's still some issues to be resolved in terms of the link to workforce issues, but I suppose it will be available very quickly, and then it will also be available on the website of the European Forum. When we did our scoping review, we used the diagram that you're seeing now. It's basically a very simple model of the processes that lead to what we've called the risk of a primary care vacuum, a low level of primary care services, and sometimes not of very good quality in remote and rural areas. And I will use this diagram during my presentation, and first start with saying something about the upper half of the diagram, and then using most of the time, or half of the time, to issues that we called policy options and general observations about the solutions that have been suggested in the literature. So let me start with this issue of the economic, social, and geographical context. You could say that there is a trend that the situation of rural and remote areas deteriorates. It's related to economic change, the change from a agriculture and industry-based economy towards a service economy. The service economy is concentrated in urban areas and also asks specific competences of the people working in the service economy that requires them to follow a long-term education, which is often not available in remote and rural areas. At the same time, we should add that the labor force in the service economy is probably less restricted to place than it used to be. But the fact that it is less restricted to place also brings people to move towards urban areas. There's also a big social change in rural areas with their rapidly aging populations and a lack of public services, libraries, schools, but also shops, and probably also healthcare facilities. There are specific areas that are in the periphery of countries, around the borders, where the situation is usually worse than in rural areas closer to the center of countries, to the population centers. And sometimes you see that through abundant houses and shops. And this is a picture that I got from the internet of a abandoned village in France, in the Auvergne area. So this is basically the economic, social, and geographical context that has consequences for the population in these areas. Remote and rural areas often suffer from population decline. Young people move towards population centers for education and employment, and consequently, population density is lower and the whole age structure has changed. Worldwide, still something like 45% of the population lives in rural areas, but this is a decreasing share of the population due to the big moves of urbanization in all over the world. But still, it's big enough and important enough to have a special attention from health policymakers. That all have to deal with the problems of rural areas in terms of healthcare supply. On the right-hand part of the diagram that I showed you at the beginning, I'll just quickly go back to this and show where it was. So I discussed economic, social, and geographical context, population decline. I now move to the consequences of this population decline in terms of the health and social situation of the population. An aging population everywhere, not only in rural and remote areas, coincides with multiple chronic health problems and often also combined with social problems. And the social problems are probably more specific for remote and rural areas, especially problems of isolation, but also a potential lack of informal carers. When the younger people and children move towards the population centers, the older people, their parents, their grandparents, stay behind and probably increasingly lack informal carers that are so important for their health and well-being. And this makes health problems more complex and requires a population and person-centered approach. It's not only just going into the issues of lack of primary care supply, but also a different focus on the primary care supply that is probably needed. As Diana said, if you want to ask questions, just put them in the chat box and Diana will see that I can get them here and on my screen and give you the answers if I have them. But I would also be interested in sharing your experiences with rural primary care in your country. On the left-hand side of the diagram was the one of the consequences of the changes in economic, social, and geographical structure of rural areas. And one of the consequences is a low supply of a lack of a large area of services, but also of primary care. And what we found in the literature was that this is partly a consequence of a dropping share of generalists among physicians in many countries. The choice for being a family physician or general practitioner is less often made compared to a choice for one of the medical specialties. And this puts greater pressure on primary care everywhere, both in the cities and in the countryside. But there might be additional reasons why people don't want to practice in rural areas. And one of them might be professional isolation, and another one might be the problem, or at least the idea that there is a problem in finding jobs for your partner and finding educational opportunities for your children. Also, in rural and remote areas, the financial accessibility of care seems to be less good than in urban areas. The diagram is taken from the International Labour Organization, and it shows worldwide the number of people that are not covered by universal access to care, either by legislation or by health insurance. And you can see that there's a large difference in coverage between urban and rural areas worldwide. To bring this idea of a low supply of primary care a bit closer to what it means for individual GPs, I took some information which will not be in the policy brief and the background report, but which I took from the Qualico PC study, and I only took the European countries, some 30 countries and 7,000 GPs, and I looked at the distance to the nearest other GP practice. That is something of this idea of professional isolation. And the black areas are those who say that they there is no distance because they work at the same building, same address. And then you have the different categories. And you can see that if you look at big cities where there's nearly always another GP practice within 10 kilometers distance, you compare that to rural areas where there's some 15% of practices would have to travel more than 20 kilometers to reach another GP practice. If you look at the distance to a hospital, to the nearest hospital, there's an even bigger gradient from big cities to rural areas. And this is both related to professional isolation, but also to hospital services as a backup and the referral possibility for primary care physicians. So there is really a difference over all these 30 countries in the distance to other professionals, be it other GPs or be it hospitals. Now, bringing this one step further closer to us, I just looked at rurality in two countries, Norway and the Netherlands. Norway, as a country with a lot of rural areas, there's a low population density, 16 inhabitants per square kilometer, and the Netherlands as a European country with one of the highest population densities, over 400 people per square kilometer. And you would probably say that rurality and rural primary care can't be a problem in a country like the Netherlands. But what we find in the literature and in day-to-day experience is that something like rurality and distance is very relative to what you're used to and to the scale of the country you live in. The same distance might be very close to the feeling for someone in a country with a very low population density, and would be a large distance in a country like the Netherlands. We have areas in the periphery of the country with a decreasing population size, and aging population, where it is increasingly difficult to find new GPs, and where there are action programs now to increase the number of GPs to not get into problems in the coming years. But if you look at these two measures of professional isolation that I just showed for all these 30 countries, and you look at it for the Netherlands and Norway, you see this huge difference in population density and the upmake of a country. So the distance to the nearest GP in rural areas in the Netherlands, it's for nearly all less than 10 kilometers. Whilst in Norway, in rural areas, half of the GPs have to travel over 20 kilometers to the nearest GP. And with hospitals, that's even stronger. 93% of Norwegian rural GPs would have to travel over 20 kilometers to a hospital. Well, that's less than 40% in the Netherlands. So the comparing these countries is relative to the situation in the country. And you could say that it nuances a bit the problems of a country, but at the same time, the effects of rurality seem to be more or less the same, independent of the size of the country. Now, these developments together, this low supply of primary care and increased health problems in the population, define together the risk of what you could call a primary care vacuum, a situation where people have little or no access to primary care in areas where needs are increasing. We saw in our literature review that the quality of primary care in rural areas is in some countries lower than in urban areas. It's not in all countries, but in some countries, and I think that's an important issue to try to tackle. It relates to lack of up-to-date equipment in primary care, sufficiently qualified staff, and access to this backup by specialized and hospital care in the form of referral possibilities if necessary. It also seems to be difficult to provide integrated care in remote and rural areas, including preventive care and social care, to assure the continuity of care and to provide specific services that usually require a larger population numbers or specific organizational arrangements, such as end-of-life care. And as I said, the health situation with an aging population and increasing multi-morbidity and social problem in remote and rural areas actually requires this kind of services. And that could, in the long run, lead to a kind of a feedback loop where a lack of high quality and accessible primary care can reduce population health in the longer run and create an even greater need for primary care. So basically, if I go back to this diagram that I showed before, I'm now gone quickly through this whole upper part of the diagram. And I now move to the policy options, but maybe before I actually do that, I would like to ask Diana, are there already questions or experiences that people want to share with the audience?
No, for the moment, no. But if you come up with something, please just write or let me know if you want to intervene.
Okay. So for the time being, everything is clear.
Yes. Yeah. Otherwise, I will have some questions afterwards. But yeah.
Okay, that's fine. But then I move to this box with the policy options, and we grouped policy options in basically in five categories: task shifting, recruitment and retainment of staff, supportive interventions, mobility interventions, and technology interventions. And we added a number of general conditions that would have to be taken into account when we introduce one of these policy options. So I go through each and every one of these policy options. The task shifting issue is an important one. You can see in a number of countries that tasks in rural and remote areas are moved from primary care physicians towards primary care nurses. Basically, this is very well possible as well as it is in other areas, in more urban areas. But there are some general conditions that should be taken into account if we want to shift tasks. The quality of care should be equivalent to the quality before delegation. We should be aware of all kinds of legal and regulatory constraints when we introduce task shifting. So sometimes it would need changes in the legal situation and in the things that nurses are allowed to do. Another kind is a condition that it should be accepted both by the delegating physicians, and I would add the ones who take over the task of the physicians, but also of the patients. So the trust relationship that patients tend to build with their family physicians, they should also be able to build with a primary care or family nurse. And basically, we have to look at the optimal skill mix within primary care teams. And these teams might be established in population centers and have outreach teams or outreach locations basically run by primary care nurses in close relation to the primary care physicians that work in the centers. But basically the skill mix of the whole team is important. It also requires sufficient funding and remuneration of staff, access to professional development, adequate mentoring, supervision, and of course clarity with regard to the scope of tasks and responsibilities. It's not just the easy solution, well, let the nurses do the job. There's a lot more that comes about this. What's often not taken into account is that you may want to shift tasks to, for instance, primary care nurses, but there might be also difficulties in attracting and retaining primary care nurses in remote and rural areas. So the same things that go for primary care physicians probably also go for primary care nurses. In addition to that, I would say that the literature on primary care in rural and remote areas is strongly focused on the position of physicians and leaves other professions like nurses, physiotherapists, etc., out of scope. Recruitment and training of staff is a policy option and strategy that has been used but could be used much better. One of them is related to the recruitment of students with a rural background into medical education, and it's also often said that the whole medical curriculum should be adapted to the possibility of people moving to and working in rural practice. Rural training and immersion is important. An example is the University of Tromsø in the north of Norway, which was established in the early 1970s, partly with a view to attracting students to these areas where they had problems in recruiting and retaining retaining health professionals. There's also experience now in a number of countries with rural exposure programs for medical students and internships during undergraduate training. These programs differ largely between countries and between universities, from only 1 or 2 days to much longer internships in rural practice. What the literature shows is that there might be an additional benefit that the clinical skills of students who have worked as interns in rural primary care have better clinical skills, improved clinical skills compared to those who only worked in urban areas. And it's important that students be exposed to rural primary care in a very early stage of their education, and that the program should be targeted to candidates who are likely to enter rural practice. So probably targeted to people who have already a slight preference for wanting to work in rural areas. So that's the big area in the literature on recruitment and training of staff. It's always also emphasized that all interventions that we develop should have additional supportive interventions. So there should be professional support in the form of cooperation among peers, among primary care providers, and the development of professional networks, access to continuing professional development and professional education, and also career development programs, so that it is possible to have a real career also in rural areas, with the different steps that are common in more urban areas. Care networks should be developed to support access to referral care and advice, and that should increase this referral backup by medical specialists and hospitals and reduce isolation. Apart from these more professional support interventions, personal support is not often mentioned in the literature. Only very few research mentions something like programs for partners of primary care workers who decide to go to work in rural and remote areas, or support for their children in getting a place for their education. And I think this is an increasingly important issue in many countries, but it should be developed further. There's no real experience with how these kind of support, personal support programs would have to look like. This is a picture, it's called a Medibus. It's a mobile practice, and I found this picture in the magazine of the German Railways, Deutsche Bahn. I was traveling from Berlin to the Netherlands and just a bit tired and leaving to one of these magazines, and suddenly I saw a small article on rural Hessen, one of the states in Germany, where someone had started in a bus, a practice in a bus, and went through the villages, say once or twice per week. And that's part of this policy option of mobility support. And the example of the Medibus is where healthcare workers are mobile and go to patients. It might be only a short-term solution to a lack of primary care. In the long term, mobile healthcare workers is probably not a very good idea because of long-term consequences, for instance, for continuity of care, the difficulty to reach people in situations where they need more than probably once or twice a week someone from primary care. And basically, if mobile services healthcare workers, bringing healthcare workers to patients are being developed, it should be accompanied by steps to develop primary care facilities locally again. So basically, it looks from the literature that it's more like a temporary solution than a long-term solution. The other side of mobility support is to make patients mobile or support the mobility of patients to be able to come to healthcare facilities. It is stressed in the literature that patient preferences should be taken into account. You cannot probably have patients travel with everybody. They might have their want to travel only with trusted parties. It was once suggested that all these parcel services that travel over all the countries to bring the internet packages around, that they could also take up people and bring them to healthcare centers. But the question is, of course, whether people want to do this, whether they really have enough trust in people that bring parcels, that they can also bring persons around. And there might be all kinds of legal and logistical constraints in these kind of solutions. But in the end, you see that a lot of people try to organize to get to a primary healthcare facility in a population center with their neighbors, with their friends, with their family. But of course, the problem is that the number of younger people and family that could do that is also decreasing. So mobility support is only part of a solution and probably more supportive to other solutions than a solution in itself. The part of ICT support and telehealth is developing quickly. In a lot of cases, remote diagnosis, treatment and monitoring becomes possible. The literature says that it would be most suitable for managing chronic illness, where people need support in self-management, but not so much of acute care. And again, this is rather a support than a real solution to primary care shortages. When it's implemented in rural and remote areas, we should be sure that the adequate infrastructure and the training of staff is there, that professional roles and protocols are well defined, that the end users, the patients, are involved in the development and implementation of these technical support services. Not only the patients, but also, of course, the primary care workers. To make sure that these technologies fit with the normal workflow in primary care and that the quality of clinical care is safeguarded. So there's quite a list of conditions that we should take into account when we want to introduce telehealth and ICT support on a bigger scale. But it's inevitable that it's going to be done also, and not only in rural areas, but also in urban areas. So we can learn within countries from developments in this area. So then there are some general observations and conditions that we came across when doing this review and from previous experience. The first one is that also in rural and remote areas, the development of primary care is an important goal. And there is the feeling that strong primary care may more easily be implemented in rural areas than in city areas. The whole healthcare supply situation is often less complex in rural areas. The catchment population for primary care services is more easily defined. You don't have to deal with numerous hospitals, but often only with one. And in a population settlement, most of the people will tend to have their services from the same primary care service. So there's much less coordination necessary, and it's probably easier to have continuous and well organized care on a territorial basis in rural areas. Another important general condition is effective governance. Of course, that's important in the implementation of all kinds of policies in healthcare, but especially in improving the situation in rural and remote areas, governance includes good instruments for instance, for workforce planning and the possibilities of interventions to change the distribution of primary care services. Also, a comprehensive approach is important. There are lots of studies that look at one small intervention type, but to be effective, the idea is that policies must address a full range of factors associated with rural and remote primary care, recruitment and retention, and they should be carefully targeted to the local situation, the local context. So the first step would be a good analysis of the local situation. And effective strategies should be combined strategies and multifaceted. Local involvement and support. So policies should be developed together with healthcare workers and the population. If we look at restrictive and coercive policies, these may lead to unmotivated healthcare workers, and in the end, they may harm the quality of care. And support of the population is very important because of the acceptance of and trust in new care arguments influence their use. And as I already said, due to the changing health situation in rural and remote areas, we need a people-centered approach that both looks at the communities and the population and at the individuals, the persons. The solutions to primary care shortage should involve communities and explore the potential of communities in taking action. Primary care policies should be coordinated with policies to strengthen the social structure of local communities. In some countries, citizen initiatives come up in rural areas where people start organizing themselves to provide services like community service, like libraries, small shops, but also to try to attract adequate primary care services. And the potential of this self-organization of local communities should be used when we think of changing the primary care situation in local communities. And finally, it's important that there's a good monitoring and evaluation of the interventions that are being done to improve the healthcare situation in primary care in rural areas. Partly to have more scientific evidence on what works and what works where in what context. And that would add to the potential of learning between countries. Things that are effective in one country could be used in other countries, depending on a very good analysis of the local context and the health system context, of course. There's also a number of debatable solutions that we came across, especially if applied isolated. Financial incentives are an example, and this issue of obligatory services, what I said previously, coercive type of interventions. There's a lot of ways that countries try to make it attractive to work in rural areas by scholarships and loan relief, higher remuneration, and all these kinds of things. But what the literature says is that to have a real impact is that these incentives need to be implemented in combination with other measures, and then they might work as a kind of a supplementary intervention to other policy options. The issue of early career physicians being obliged to work in rural practice for a certain period of time before they can have a job in the public system in their country, such as, for instance, exists in Greece, may not be suitable as a strategy for long-term recruitment. We don't have data on how many of these early career physicians in the end decide to stay in a rural or in the Greek case, in an island context. But there's a clear risk of motivation problems. People are just sitting there for 2 years or 1 year to get access to a better life in their perception. So these kind of solutions should be only used in relation to others and with a really good eye for the unintended consequences. So in just over half an hour, I've gone through this scoping review. I hope that there are questions and experiences to be shared, and I would also like to focus your attention to the next conference of the European Forum for Primary Care. It's not focused on rural primary care. It could be an idea for one of the upcoming conferences, but it's focused on local communities, this whole issue of primary care relating to local communities, and its subtitle is Health Equity for Everyone, Everywhere. So this was my presentation, and I really look forward to your comments.
Yes, hi Peter. I'm trying to see, because I think what it would really be interesting is to hear from someone from the audience if they have any examples of policy implementation in rural areas. But I'm trying to see if someone wants to step up. For the moment, no. But I just have one question, because you have been talking about research and the report, and does the report actually include like real examples of initiatives that have been taken forward in countries?
We have added just a couple of examples. We didn't want to make the report very very big, so we added some 5 or 6 boxes, page by boxes, where we describe the specific situation in a country or an initiative. Yeah.
Okay. So they come. Great. I still don't see anyone coming up, but and how, in your personal view, how do you see the tendencies that governments want to take this forward and straightening more rural health, or do you see like they tend to abandon this topic and just don't want to hear about it for the moment?
I think that will differ between countries. The situation in some countries is already for a longer time that they will take up these issues, like for instance in the Scandinavian countries. They're quite used to having large distances, and the example of, for instance, this university in the north of Norway, in Tromsø, was an initiative started by government policy already in the 1970s. In some countries, there will be kind of new problems. I think of the example of Finland, where a number of health centers in remote rural areas have problems in finding GPs to staff the health centers. And what's happening then is that commercial firms bring in physicians to staff these health centers, but with two associated big problems. One is discontinuity. So every now and then, and very often, there's a new physician brought in. And the other thing is that the costs are much higher when you hire staff from a commercial enterprise to staff the centers than when you would have people working there in employed by the centers. So that brings new problems that that forces authorities to start new policies.
Okay. Well, there is a question now. And the question is about data. So it's asking if there is any data challenge that exists when you are looking at population health in a rural versus an urban setting.
That depends a lot on the quality of the health statistics in general. I think it's not necessarily so that the data basis for assessing rural health is worse than in other areas. It depends probably a bit on the quality of primary care if the data are generated by primary care records and activities. You can imagine that the quality is worse if the quality of primary care is worse, or if there is a lack of access to services. So issues of unmet need are always difficult to measure, and especially in areas where the infrastructure is not very good anymore.
Okay. There are not more questions, but well, I was really impressed to see that still 45% of the population worldwide lives in rural areas. Do you actually know what is the percentage in Europe? Because I think a majority of the audience would be from.
I don't know that by heart, but I certainly could find out. But I don't think it's so much less, because the biggest change in urbanization are in developing countries and middle-income countries. Think of the huge cities that you have in some African countries now, and in South America and in Asia. Europe doesn't, but in a bit generalizing, Europe doesn't have the huge cities, only a few, London, Paris, it has a lot of smaller cities. So I think that the situation is qualitatively different from the global situation.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you, Peter. Diana.
Yeah, it's Pavlov talking, so I think he wants to say something.
Is somebody else? Or you?
No, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, thank you, Peter. Thank you, Peter, for this great presentation. Okay, personally, me and Brianna were very familiar with the work because we participated in the development. Actually, what I would like to say here is that also with the number of these 45% that you gave, this was actually the reason that we came up with the necessity of this work, because, you know, we are talking about the challenges that our health systems and our populations, actually our populations first, and then our health systems will face in the forthcoming years. For example, the rise of NCDs, but we are not talking about who is going to deal with these issues. And, you know, with the whatever very super duper systems we can come up, there must be people there, and there must be primary healthcare people there to deal with these issues. And this rural vacuum, as you call it, is a reality from the most high income countries on the planet to the lowest income countries of the planet, from Denmark to Sierra Leone, from Beverly Hills, California, to Egaleo, Athens, who is a deprived area in the outskirts of Athens. So Thank you very much. On behalf of WHO, I would like to say that for actually opening this issue very, very soon. There are some comments from the health workforce departments. To be honest, I haven't seen them personally, but I hope to see them this week. And after that, we will go very quickly to the publication of the report, which actually, in my opinion, will be only the starting point of a very, very big initiative that we should all work together, because this is the problem that all the ministers of health of all the 194 countries across the globe have and will have for the next decades. And one more point from my side, we covered very well the rural area, but we can see that this sort of vacuum also exists in the urban areas, and especially in the underserved areas, where actually most the most vulnerable population. We have discussed that, and there are also in the report points that also reflect this issue. And probably in the near future, we should also see in parallel both these issues that have a lot of common grounds, actually. So these were a few comments from my side, and I would like to thank you once more and congratulate you for the excellent work.
Thank you, Pavlos. I think there's a couple of very important things in what you've said. The first one is this issue that still slightly less than half of the world population lives in rural areas. So it is very important that we take this issue of the problems of primary care in rural areas into account. I also think it's important to integrate the workforce aspects as well as possible within the policy brief and the comments and the background report, because many of the solutions are related to workforce issues, to focusing the workforce to a local population, to increase population and person-centered care, to try to more have a more planned approach to workforce issues. So that's really very important to integrate that. And finally, I think that that again, I completely agree that there's a lots of problems also in urban primary care. The only thing is that I think the background is different, the whole context is different, and probably also the solutions are different. But surely there's also big problems in organizing primary care in some areas in urban in big cities. The really disintegrated areas in urban cities that really require not only good primary care but also community development. So there's parallels, but there's a lot of difference in the context that we should take into account.
Great. I think there's no more questions. Well, there is someone asking you.
Oh, no, that's here. Yeah. Implementation strategies. I think that the whole report is not very big. We had to make it as a quick review in a very short time. But as you might have seen from a number of these things that I mentioned conditions for implementation, and also in these general observations, basically they cover some of the implementation problems that you might encounter when you start implementing one of the policy options. So it is covered, but not very widely, but it also contains all the references to the literature that says a bit more about that. But in general, the whole issue of implementation is very important. We cannot change the world by just saying the what has to be done without saying how it has to be done. So the whole issue of how is important.
Well, I think with that a strong message, we can actually finish the webinar because it's already almost time, and I don't think there are not more questions yet. But I just want to take this few minutes just to thank you, basically, and to thank all of the people present in this webinar. I think it's been quite interesting, inclusive for myself, because I didn't know this data, and there is a lot of work to do, and there is a plea there for improving rural health. But thank you so much, and hopefully, I don't know if there is you have a page where they can contact you in case they have any questions, or a contact email,
so people they can all. Yeah, I had my email somewhere at the end of the presentation. Let me see, not this one, but the previous one. So here's my email address, as you can always email me. Oh no, it's not the email; it's the website. The email address is just p.groenewegen@nivel.nl.
Okay.
But basically, I think when the report is and the policy brief are being published by WHO, at the same time we will also publish them on the website of the European Forum. So join the European Forum, look at the website, and find the information.
Great. So thank you, Peter. I think that was clear. We are much looking forward for the report too.
Okay. Well, everybody, thanks, and hope to see you again. Bye.
Thank you.